I've been invited to share some thoughts about the role of the international community with regard to responding to crises, to talk about the way these actors could best help nations facing crises while maintaining the momentum of the sustainable development goals, to talk about the existing synergies for an effective and fast response, as well as the way development made societies more resilient. I'm happy to do so. However, it is challenging to clearly respond to these questions, because the actions and the roles in responding to crises are dependent on the type of crisis, and because international actors, as well as their contribution, could be diverse. The international community is a big machine. The main actors in responding to crises are the international and regional organizations, the donors, the country international agencies, the global civil society actors such as NGOs, social movements, networks, think tanks, commissions, and the media. They share the same goal, which is to save lives while ensuring basics for survival. Their actions consist in early warning, preparedness, capacity building, fundraising, influencing, but also research to gather evidence about the state of knowledge and to develop learning in order to improve policy and practices. The perspective I'm going to share here comes from interviews I had with Oxfam field actors in West Africa, country directors, humanitarians, advocacy and campaign coordinators, and fundraising managers. So far, I've learned a lot, especially regarding the fundamental role in struggling with crises and their consequences, but also regarding cooperation, resilience, preparedness, and the challenges they face. The first support the international community could provide to the nations should happen in prevision of any crisis. Preparedness includes vulnerability assessment by doing an audit on the vulnerable areas, the nation's ability and resources, an audit on the presence of other international actors and the identification of who is doing what. By doing an identification of anything that could lead to or exacerbate a crisis and the potential solutions. Preparedness also includes planning to effectively manage and minimize casualties. The goal is to plan actions for immediate response in order to alleviate the effect of the crisis, especially regarding the sustainable development goals. Then, preparedness includes communication, meaning early awareness, information sharing, and learning from best practices. During the crisis, the international community should work in identifying and addressing practical and strategic needs. Practical needs by the delivery of direct assistance, food, wash, protection. In doing so, the international community will also evolve non-predictable induced issues. The international community should also address strategic needs by accounting for non-predictable dynamics induced by the crisis. Some researchers show some post-disaster changes and the destruction of the social structure that could lead to worsening the conditions and the livelihoods of the most vulnerable peoples. Researchers report the amplification of gender role and identities, as well as the transformation of gender relations. Failing to account for the strategic needs could lead to failure in ensuring the sustainable development goals. An example we have in West Africa, following the Ebola outbreak, is the emergence of a new community, the Ebola survivors. These people are living, facing discrimination and stigma, while dealing with their own trauma. The international community works to ensure the respect of the survivors' fundamental rights and dignity, and to ensure that this community will be taken into account and protected by the government in the same way that the overall population. After the crisis, the international community should work to ensure the reinforcement of the nations and the communities' capabilities to prevent, manage, and respond to crises by building their resilience. The development programs should be linked whenever possible to long-term development actions to ensure the grounds of the sustainable development goals. Then it is important to raise evidence-based knowledge through research to improve future responses. Cooperation is the strategy usually adopted by the international actors to mitigate their weaknesses in facing crises and to ensure effective responses. International actors have made significant attempts to combine their efforts in order to be able to respond to crises. Partnerships include sharing information, joint operations and projects, sharing resources. For instance, the international and regional organizations are the most important actors in the provision of humanitarian aid and development assistance. NGOs generally have strong expertise working with communities and population, as well as a significant network in the countries. To be efficient, the international actors should work at identifying the horizontal and vertical partnerships they could engage in. For NGOs such as Oxfam, horizontal partnership means working with other NGOs with a different domain of expertise, such as Save the Children, Médecins Sans Frontières, Amnesty International, and so forth. Vertical partnerships mean working with international and regional organizations, donors, think tanks, the media, but also local actors such as governments, communities, national civil society actors, and so forth. I have here some examples of Oxfam cooperation in West Africa. Regarding vertical cooperation in Mali, for instance, Oxfam ensures a close and trusting relationship with communities through the implementation of a committee of complaint. This committee allows the communities to complain if the intervention does not respect what was planned. Oxfam works with local NGOs and civil society organizations to improve their capacity to conduct humanitarian-related activities in food security, livelihood, and wash. Oxfam raised funds through public appeals and private donations. Oxfam receives logistic support provided by the UN. In terms of horizontal cooperation, Oxfam is member of a consulting group for international NGOs which work together to provide humanitarian assistance, to share approach regarding the way of working and who is doing what, to agree about common advocacy programs, to raise an early warning about vulnerable people, vulnerable areas, to share security information. They also work together to increase their effectiveness in attracting funds. An efficient response also depends on the government spirit of cooperation and reaction. During the Niger flood in 2010, the environment was not favorable since it was the worst famine and flooding in Niger's history. But the collaboration between the government, the NGOs, the media, the donors, and the communities led to an efficient response. Regarding development assistance and resilience, Crises definitely break the development process and, in some extent, uncover fragile statehood and government weaknesses in the ability to protect their population and or to react appropriately. Development assistance could be considered in addition to humanitarian actions in order to rebuild and reestablish basic social, economic, and productive infrastructures, but also to reduce long-term vulnerability, to reinforce the people, the communities, and the nation's ability to adapt and to recover promptly following a crisis, meaning to be more resilient. The international actors now recognize that risk reduction and resilience should be established in both humanitarian and development thinking. I would like to share some actions undertaken regarding this point. The Global Resilience Partnership is an existing instrument convened by USAID, the Rockefeller Foundation, and the Swedish Development Agency that aim to help people adapt and invest in more resilient future to build resilience rather than only focusing on repair. In Afghanistan, the World Health Organization provides training to respond to the shortage of health workers, especially to women and people in the most isolated communities. This favors a body of health workers to treat and save their own people. The organization ensured the availability of medicine and medical equipment, especially in the disaster-prone areas. Oxfam works to deliver immediate aid through local market structures whenever possible. This contributes to support and reinforce infrastructures, local economies, and ensure sustainable responses. To finish, I would like to share challenges and limitations my colleagues stressed regarding the response to crises and conclude with a bit of advocacy. The first one is about the difficulty to reallocate funds devoted to development assistance and to struggle with persistent humanitarian issues. For instance, in Mali, the signature of the peace agreements following the conflict led to an increase of the budget allocated to the development assistance to the detriment of humanitarian actions. The issue is that actors are trying to rebuild or build in some insecure areas or areas where humanitarian crisis is ongoing, which guarantees neither the implementation nor the achievement. The last point is about the respect of donors' commitment. In addition, the recent migration crisis in Europe turns away the attention of donors, and this is worrying for ongoing crises in West Africa. For instance, with the world's largest humanitarian crisis in the Lake Chad basin has a hard time to attract the media attention and to raise funds. Thank you.